TCL 650 presents your source for leading-edge news and information on today's hottest products and services. This is Experts on Call.
Welcome to our show. I'm Tony Gioventu, the host of Key Pacific's Talk About Strata. We're going to talk tonight with Dan O'Hearn, who is the managing broker for Key Pacific Management. And we're going to be talking about your relationship with your strata management company, the roles and responsibilities, you know, what makes it work, what makes it challenging, and all of those issues that we have to deal with as strata council. So welcome to the show, Dan.
It's great to be here. Thanks very much, Tony.
So how many years have you been in the business?
I've been in the business for close to 30 years in different aspects of real estate. Key Pacific's been around for about 20, and we're located in New Westminster. We find it a good central location, and it's a great place to be serving the public. So we've got good staff there. Most of our managers have over 8 years of experience, and our executives are come from many years in different aspects of real estate as well. So got a good team there.
And why strata? Of all the parts of real estate, why would you find strata the interest?
I love the question because most people groan when I say I'm in property management and strata management. It's particularly challenging, but I think what I love about it, and I think the people that get involved in it really like that, it's about building communities. It's about relationships. It's about helping people not only take care of their property, but to feel good about where they live. And that's the aspect that I find the most rewarding. And it's also the aspect that is sometimes the most challenging. I've got an expression that this job would be easy if people didn't live in the buildings.
A lot of things would be easier if people weren't involved. But really what you're saying, though, is that this is all about human relationships.
It is. Yeah. It may be property there, and you may be talking about these assets and talking about money, but it always boils down to it's the people that are involved that are making these decisions, right? And so it's the people moving throughout the building that cause the problems. It's the people that have to approve for the funding to repair the problems. And so the relationships, you know, we're called property managers, but really you almost need a degree in psychology, right? Because you're always dealing with aspects of the people.
So your property managers come social workers.
I think so at times.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. And you're now inserted into the day-to-day life of a community. You know, whether it's a 16-unit townhouse complex or a 260-unit development that includes commercial and residential. And so there's all of the interactions of all these personalities in these communities. So there must be days when it's incredibly interesting and days when it's incredibly frustrating at the same time.
It's a cruel mistress because you have those days that are magical and that you've done something great and you're acknowledged for it, and that just makes you feel so good you can just carry on for weeks and months. And then there's other people that really they just don't appreciate anything you've done,
right.
And you just have to take satisfaction yourself knowing you've done the right thing, you've done the right job, and understand you can't always please everyone 100% of the time. We're always in the situation in the middle, trying to mediate something between a homeowner and the council, or a contractor and the council, or between neighbors. We're always drawn into the middle of it.
So let's talk about the relationship a little bit. Under the strata property legislation, strata corporations are permitted to hire a management company.
Mm-hmm.
Under the Real Estate Services Act, strata management services are licensed and regulated. And what we have is a created relationship called agency.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that agency relationship, you essentially, as the strata management company and the managers, are an extension of the strata council and the strata corporation. And how does that work, and how does it play itself out in day-to-day relationships, you know, working with a contractor, for example?
Well, the agent is the one who's acting on behalf of the corporation. I mean, we are in effect stepping in the shoes of the corporation. We're given that authority, and it's fairly broad authority. We're taking direction from our client, and our client is always the strata corporation who elects a council, so we deal with the council on all those things. So you know, a lot of homeowners may feel we're working specifically for them, and that is true to some degree, but our direction has to come from the authority that they vested in the council. And then the council, of course, deals with us. So that's how the agency agreement works. Normally, we're entitled to enter into contracts on their behalf, to negotiate on their behalf. You know, this is the most effective way to govern a strata corporation.
It's interesting because from the, you know, the CHOA information side where we get all the calls from consumers and strata councils, we generally deal with, it's nice to hear that you have great days where you get a lot of kudos, and generally we kind of feel like we're the crisis line. We get to deal with the complaints and the calls. And
of course.
And I think one of the most common calls we get is, how do we get a good management company?
Right.
And we have that discussion with strata corporations, and we often have to go back to the ground base of, what do you want? Mm-hmm. Right. What are your expectations? How much time are you anticipating your manager is going to spend on your project? What are all the obligations and the roles and responsibilities that you're passing on to this manager? And so when we look at all those relationships, you know, we often take the approach that the start of a good management relationship is the start of a good management contract also.
Yes.
A clear understanding between the strata council, the strata owners, and the strata management company of what the deliverables are.
Mm-hmm.
What are we going to pay you? How are we acknowledging that? And what are we going to, what are you doing for us in exchange? But, you know, everybody has breakdowns.
Mm-hmm.
So in relationships, and so how do we maintain those from a management relationship perspective to the strata, so that that becomes a long-term sustainable relationship?
Well, yeah, from the start, which you've been a big advocate of laying out, you know, an appendix of a contract spells out all the deliverables, and we're really for that. I think the councils, when they make the selection, they have to understand it's not just who says that they will manage effectively, because all management companies are going to do more or less the same thing. We're all going to say that we're going to do a great job for you. And a lot of times what people will do is they'll boil it down to price. But really, if it boils down to that, then there's certain expectations that they may have, and there's certain expectations the strata management firm may have. And unless you really discuss those thoroughly, no one really knows. It's all projections, right? So you have to let them know what projects are coming up, what needs to be done, how involved you want the management company to be.
Well, and essentially every year, you end up potentially with a new client.
Every year, it's a new. People don't realize that there has to be some corporate memory, and that's what the strata management company really can do, right? The building's there for the next 100 years. The management company, we hope, is there for 50 or 100 years. We're going to be the corporate memory, but what you have is a building that is filled with people who live on average there 5 or 10 years, managed by a council who are sometimes on council for 1 year or two. So you can see you're going to lose a lot of that consistency. So you're looking for a management company that can give you guidance and knows the history of the building and can then project forward what needs to be done and really guide you down that path. You know, because everyone's looking for different services, we've also created 3 different levels of service to appeal to that.
Right.
And so what we've done is we've created a consulting-only package. So if all you need is some advice or a manager to come out and help with a council meeting or an AGM, SGM, help you with some bylaws, help you arrange quotations, we can do that just on a consulting level. And it might be similar to what CHOA offers, because I know you often are consulting with people, but you may be more on the governance side, whereas we can be more hands-on. Then we offer a consulting accounting, because accounting is one of the most important functions that we do. So we can do an accounting and then supplement it with additional consulting. And then finally, it's full service, and full service is what people expect from a property manager that's going to do everything. So, and those will be all different levels of affordability, and that's going to be applicable to small buildings or large. We have a consulting accounting client who's almost 200 units. The difference, though, is they have a very, very active, involved council. And so they have some cost savings. And the advantage of them dealing with us is that they can pick and choose the different jobs that need to be done.
Right.
And anything they don't want, maybe it's nasty bylaw enforcement, they may give that to us. If it's getting quotes for carpet cleaning, they may enjoy to do that because they want to be involved in their building. And the benefit of us staying involved at that level is that when that council is gone and those abilities are gone, or the new council members don't want to do any work, we can easily step into the shoes of full management positions. So that's why we've created three different types of service levels.
So, and we've seen that in the industry now too, where conventional models of strata management have started to change. Mm-hmm. We now have, you know, for want of a better word, people are using boutique services. You know,
yes.
your strata council can actually retain a company that is going to provide you a catered service specifically for what your needs are.
Yes.
But that's flexible. Year by year, that can change.
Yeah.
And it would be reflected within service agreements, within fees that are paid and compensated. You know, it's up to the Strata Corporation. It is a kind of a quirky thing, though, that when we deal with this, we're dealing with a group of volunteers. You know, take a typical 100-unit high-rise building that's probably has a corporate value of $30 million. And we've just put a group of volunteers to now make the decisions about the corporate function.
Mm-hmm.
So having a valuable relationship that is stable with a management company is probably one of the most important things this community is going to have.
I don't want to sound conceited, but the management contract is probably the single most important contract you're going to place.
Right. Right. I agree entirely. And so it's important for the Strata Corporation to, especially the Strata Council, you know, you have new Strata Council each year, for them to understand what the relationship is in the contract, you know, what the roles of each of the parties. You know, I think a lot of the decisions or a lot of the complaints that we see or confusion is because the parties don't understand the relationship between the Strata Council and the Strata Management Company.
What the expectations are.
Absolutely.
We have a 369 program. So on the third month, we have one of our executives contact the council to see if we're meeting their expectations. On the sixth month, we have the property manager meet with the council and look at where we are. We're halfway through this fiscal year. Are we where we expect to be? Is there any changes that need to be done? And then on the ninth month, we do a private confidential inquiry with the various council members to make sure that we as a company and our property managers are living up to expectations. It's, like I said, it's called property management. It's all about communication and managing expectations.
The overwhelming part for most strata corporations is certainly about communication and managing expectations.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there every year CHOA delivers seminars across the province, and the theme is basically the same base of questions, the same information, and it's basically administration and facilities. You know, how do we administer our property? How do we manage our facility and protect our assets?
Yes.
When we come back, we'll start talking about bylaws a bit and bylaw enforcement, because it takes a lot of time out of the daily operation for a strata manager.
Yes.
when you're dealing with a bylaw enforcement issue. And so this is 650 Sea Isle, and you are listening to Key Pacific's Talk About Strata.
This is Experts on Call on Sea Isle 650.